So after last week's episode of The Faraway Paladin, I saw a lot of mixed opinions on both the bishop, the head bishop, as well as the crown prince. And when it came to the prince, I was a bit of a coin toss, but leaning on he probably isn't an evil prince. But when it came to the bishop, I firmly was like, wow, this is refreshing. It's a very interesting take, because typically the old angry bishop character is just an asshole who doesn't understand religion, but clearly this bishop understands religion, hence why they didn't need to test Will, because he recognized that he actually was a follower of Gracefield. But I actually saw a lot of pushback on both of those characters, and I had some great discussions, especially towards the prince side of things in the comments last week, and I'm really happy to see that both the head bishop and the crown prince turned out to be great guys. I mean, when it comes to the prince side of things, everything from his point of view makes a lot of sense. You have this very powerful warrior randomly popping up, destroys a wyvern, and apparently is two people were able to take down something an army would normally struggle with. Is also claiming that he wants a private army to operate in your borders. That is basically a recipe for disaster. That is basically a calamity in the making, and threatening to kill him is probably the most logical thing. I saw a lot of people say that threatening someone like Will, who just snapped a wyvern's neck, isn't the most smart thing to do. Well, that's definitely true. The Crown Prince is also a strong warrior. Will himself recognized it, but even if he couldn't actually pick up a sword, he has an entire army backing him. In that room alone, there was two very trained guards, and even Will recognized that he might be able to take those two out, but the prince would be another matter. Even if he killed the prince, which is completely against his moral code, he would have an entire army trying to kill him. So that was never going to go down. So threatening someone, despite his incredible accomplishments, I mean, when you can snap your fingers and have an army at your doorstep, you have the ability to threaten. But I love the idea that because of just natural conversation, not just getting through everything with throwing some fists, like Blood might want to do, he was actually able to accomplish that navigation and was able to recognize that, hey, you know what, this kid's a little entertaining, and maybe we just need to make you a knight, and that starts the chain of making him into a paladin. I'm also really glad that they touched upon the bishop, because I saw a lot of pushback. I myself completely bought into the head bishop, but I saw so many people really skeptic about him. So I'm glad that this episode also revealed that, I mean, the entire reason why the public looks at the vice bishop as someone who should be leading is because that's the face he was given. The vice bishop worships the head. I mean, he's pretty much saying, if anyone just like is using these blessings, these gifts from their gods, at moments we don't need them, eventually their blessings are going to be removed. And the fact that he doesn't usually let people watch him pray. So in the eyes of the public, he's someone who's not a real believer, because in the eyes of the public, a lot of them don't actually know what true belief in their gods actually means. So when a calamity or big moment actually happens, that's when the head bishop would actually use his blessings. And I think that's a very important moment for someone like Will, who very much seemed like he understood that the head bishop probably wasn't a bad guy, but also was a little cautious on why so many people didn't like him, and to see the entire reason of kind of putting on a face with the vice bishop while the head bishop does everything like that, I thought was awesome. I really enjoy those two new characters, because from their positions, everything they were saying and doing makes a lot of sense. I mean, he might be angry in terms of the bishop, but you see from his adoptive daughter to the way he talks about religion, he doesn't need rituals to understand if someone is who they say they are. Even not following the path of Gracefield, he can recognize that this dumb kid is without a doubt a firm believer of Gracefield. I love the idea that pretty much he thinks of the people as a bunch of idiots half the time, because I mean, look at half the shit they say and do. They very much don't understand what they're actually praying for half the time, but he also wants to protect them and keep them safe. And the fact that he calls Will pretty much the biggest idiot of them all, especially with what he wants to do, I thought was the icing on the cake. But I'm really glad that the prince wasn't like just there to summon an attack to make it look like he did something good, but it was more on the just completely logical side, which the show has been remarkably well done with, is just making things logically make sense. A crown prince who needs to keep his people safe, a random stranger who wants to raise a private army in your doorstep, I mean, that's something that you should probably consider killing and taking care of before it's too late. And when it came to the kind of like raising of his army afterwards, it's interesting to see someone who immediately kind of gave me a Blood vibe without totally being Blood. I mean, the idea that he won't even like tell his tales to bards and things like that, because he just does good things because he's a good person seemingly, and likes the challenge, and if there's a little pocket change to go with it, then that's awesome. But the idea that one of our new characters has at least three or four times tried to get that story out of him, I mean, that's interesting. It'll be interesting because the setup we have is if they complete it, you know, Will and him are going to have a 1v1, and it'd be interesting to see what would happen because this isn't your typical show where just because the main character is the main character, he's guaranteed gonna win every time. He's definitely very strong and powerful, but sometimes when I look at certain characters, I'm not totally sure. And that's the impression I had when I saw the prince as well, because we don't know what the prince is capable of. And Will himself in this episode said, like, I honestly don't know, because one, hasn't actually seen him fight, but two, probably got a sense that he knows what he's doing. And when it comes to the new character as well, I mean, he's a beast, so you never quite know, and that's really exciting. The Faraway Paladin really on paper doesn't look like all too much, I think, for most outsiders looking in. But when you watch episodes like these with how they take those stereotypes that typically are just the almighty prince, the dick of a bishop, and just all these different elements, you think you know where they're going, which is why I think there was so much pushback for both the prince and the head bishop, because we've seen anime. I mean, if you've seen at least three shows using these archetypes, you probably had some very negative assumptions about them. And honestly, I wasn't even fully convinced on the prince myself. I had my suspicions and was hoping so, and definitely talking with people last week made me believe in him a bit more, but even myself, I was a little worried. So it's nice to see how they take those characters and never makes it feel like things are happening for comedic reasons. What I mean is, like, there's so many times you just make a character purposely evil because that's gonna create drama. But when it comes to organized religion, especially in a world like this, I love how they continue to keep it so relevant without, like, shoving religious beliefs down your throat, but really, those religious beliefs are the character. Will is his religious beliefs here alongside the family's teaching. Like, the fact that when looking at a warrior, look at his hands, remembering blood's knowledge. So those are the things that really shape the show and really make it become something that's not just a generic fantasy show, but something that literally is the Faraway Paladin. I think, honestly, despite it maybe not getting mainstream praise, I would not be shocked in the slightest if up-and-coming light novel authors look at series like Faraway Paladin and say, you know what, there's actually something special here. I really should take note rather than just taking note of the main things that are popular. Don't get me wrong, if they're smart, they will take note of what's popular because ultimately you want your stories to sell. But I think the meat and potatoes of stories, they might look at Faraway Paladin more and more and say, you know what, there's something special here, and I really enjoyed this episode, and I'm really glad to see what's going down. I think there's an episode on Christmas, I believe, based on what I'm seeing, but I'm not sure if it's going to be delayed or not. If it does, I mean, you'll probably see Faraway Paladin next week on, like, the Monday or something, if it does air on Christmas. Just going to take a little break on the weekend there, but very excited to see where the last couple episodes are going to go for sure. But let me know your thoughts and feelings down below, your favorite moment, and where you think it's going to go with episode 11. Leave a like if you enjoyed, and subscribe if you're new around here. So until next time, everyone, please take care and have a good one.